Howdy there, partners. Welcome back to the Cactus Atlas. I'm Glenn, and today we're going to be exploring a few of the mysteries of Agua Fria National Monument. Over the last 20 years living here in Arizona, I have never once taken time to stop and explore in here. And it's a shame because once I started researching, there's a treasure trove of history and beauty to be found back here. Okay, so the first order of business on this trip today is I wanted to explore some of the more common sites that might be accessible to those without four-wheel drive, although where we are going today I think will eventually require very possibly some high clearance, if not four-wheel drive. We will figure that out as we go along, but to start off, I wanted to do a short hike to something I think is supposed to be both beautiful and historic. We find ourselves today on the Badger Springs Trail, somewhat well-known and popular trail for Phoenicians, even though it's well outside of the Phoenix area, maybe about, you know, 40, 50 minutes for those in the northern part of town. But this is supposed to take us down to the Agua Fria River, namesake of this national monument. Here are some washes or little tributaries with some water flow in them. Oftentimes, I'm sure this is probably just a dried up, sandy ditch. But we've had a lot of rain and snow in Arizona, especially in the northern climbs, which we're not far from here, like the Mogollon Rim or Flagstaff. Not terribly, terribly far, so I expect some good water flow today. The Agua Fria River is one of Arizona's perennial streams. It flows all year round. I've looked at maps, though, as you get further towards Phoenix, I'm sure ranching and other things suck all the water dry. But up where we're at, I'm expecting to see a healthy stream today. In the middle of the desert, which I always love that contrast, that irony. It's a lot more quiet than I thought. At midday, that's usually the height when people come out and people started to arrive on the trail. But really, for the most part, it's very quiet. A little chilly too. Cold weekend here for us Phoenicians. And a little damp, like I said. A little muddy. Now, when you're just walking, minding your own business, paying attention to filming, and out of the corner of your eye, this close to you, you see this big beauty staring at you, and you're not expecting it? That'll give you a jump start, let me tell you. That is kind of strange, though. I mean, that took me off guard, because I was, you know, paying attention to my camera and stuff, and boom, right there, that's a big, giant black beast. Takes your mind maybe a couple milliseconds to process and realize it's not some giant demon or a bull or something staring you down. Saw a big bull with horns out near the parking lot, but there's a herd of them and they're all afraid, like they run away usually. So it's really weird when one like that, I probably could have gone up and pet it. And I'm just kind of going with the flow where the footsteps take me. So far I've been successful. I mean, it's pretty obvious there's some tributary here. This is going to let out down into a stream. So the Agua Fria River cuts between two mesas here. One is called the Peri Mesa. That's one side where there's probably the bulk of the Indian ruins that you would want to come and see here. And then you would have Black Mesa, the side that I think you're kind of on when you're on I-17, you'd see it. And there's a couple ruins on that side also. But to get over to Peri Mesa, you gotta cross the Agua Fria River and drive through it. And I'm not anticipating having problems doing that when I do. But we'll find out soon enough. One thing to note for a little bit later, in case we don't get the same perspective up there, a lot of these Pueblo type places we're gonna see are at the top of these mesas and not on the edges, kind of more centrally located. But these people also seem to build forts. Not unlike Sears K ruin that we visited in northern Phoenix. Like at the top of like precipices on the edge of like fingers of land that jut out. I know of one such one near our next location. I don't know if I'm gonna be able to access it or have to bushwhack, but that's the kind of thing we're gonna be looking for today. This is kind of reminiscent and brings me back to the hike I did in the last year at the Water Wheel Trail up in Pace, and it's just like we're kind of following a stream very gently flowing one, luckily. I'm sure water flows are very different at different times in both places, but very much like that, very riparian, very lush, and if it were warmer, I'd expect to hear frogs back here type of place. Who would have thought that right off of I-17, just a few miles in, you have this like deep canyon. From the little bit of research and reading I did on the subject, the prehistoric people, or maybe a better term, the pre-Columbian people that lived in this area, known as the Hohokam, and down in the Phoenix area, would have lived down in the bottom of canyons like this, looking for areas where there was like washed out silt to do a type of farming. I want to say the term I read was akchin, so basically planting, I'm assuming, corn and crops like that in like little flood out areas that are not perennially flooded, but maybe just get like some flooding over the banks of rivers like this. And while I don't know why the heck you'd ever want to leave down here at the bottom in a beautiful spot like this, for whatever reason, over the next couple hundred years, maybe in the 1000s, 1100s, 1200s, the Hohokam and those people decided to move and relocate to the tops of mesas by following little tributary canyons like we did on the hike down here. And by the 14th century, so the 1300s, they think that's when the area up at the top of the mesa, the Peri Mesa tradition, flourished. There seemed to be an influx of people into this area, and then they started, rather than living in pit houses, started building like one or two room Pueblo-like structures, like one-story structures, very similar to others we've seen on the channel, way up there. Another thing that would have encouraged them moving up and out of here too is they thought that it was a little bit rainier and more wet during the time that they flourished. So there would have been more natural springs and water sources up higher than we have today. I think I keep reading that volcanic areas, a lot of basalt rock, aren't really good for springs and stuff like that, but there were water sources at the top. And for those that oftentimes ask me if I really want to move anywhere else, especially like for a job or something like that, I mean, there's really cool places all over, but it's hard to beat Arizona. I can't think of another place I'd rather live right now. And all around this whole park are the remnants of these people, if you know where to look. And one of the things you will see lots of are the markings they etched into rocks, like we're gonna find nearby here. And quick disclaimer too, I couldn't say with 100% certainty if everything we're gonna see are Hohokam etchings, petroglyphs. I've read that there were more modern tribes like the Yavapai and the Zuni that left their mark in these areas, maybe even the Hopi. But many of what we're gonna see today, I'm almost certain, are from the Hohokam, the original ones that lived here. So we're going to make our way on this trail that butts up against the rocks, and I think I already see some. We didn't have to go far. Gonna be right here. Wow. These are old and faded, so I would not be surprised if these are original Hohokam markings, but I'm not a scientist. I'm not an expert here, so if you know better than I do, you know what to do in the comments. But yeah, look at those panels. That is fantastic. That is a big score. I didn't realize how plentiful, how many there were. I've seen other panels like this, of course, but these are among some of the best I've seen in a very long time. You see like deer, probably bighorn sheep, humanoid figures, snake looking like figures, some almost completely faded. As you're looking, you'll see, I think I see a snake squiggle there. So I don't know where, you always want to know what do these things mean. I've read sometimes they're clan symbols, sometimes, who knows. But I'm going to guess that, this probably was a nice gathering place for these people. Maybe they were just chilling out And maybe the symbols don't mean anything. They were just bored, just making their own mark. I doubt that though. I doubt that. All right, I'm taking one more step back here and getting one more look at the panel before we head back up to the top of the mesa. All right, as I exit Badger Creek, or that Badger Trail hike, word to the wise, I'm kind of following what I think is the actual trail this time, which there is some that goes up on the sides there. But if it's not wet, you're better off staying in the wash. A lot more uneven on the side trail. Parts of where we're going today, I think, are going to be accessible for two-wheel drive, even low clearance. This road back here, for example, I would have no fears taking a small car, maybe not after a really heavy rain, but even today, you're going to get a little bit messy and muddy, but if you go slow, I don't think you'll get stuck back here. All right, I'm now leaving Badger Springs, which has its own little exit. And now we're getting back on I-17, or for you, the first time we're getting on I-17 today, to head up a little ways to a road called Bloody Basin Road, which is a dirt road, and one of the main roads that cuts through Agua Fria and heads over to the Tonto National Forest. In fact, there's a road, you could take that road down to Forest Road 24, I think, which will put you out in Carefree, Arizona, and Amy and I have made that drive before. I've made it a couple times, actually. And there's the official brown sign for Agua Fria National Monument, exit 259. And I think you can see Bloody Basin Road, that dirt road, right off to the side, hopefully, off camera. I think we're gonna be on that. And it's a well-maintained road until you get out a ways, then it gets pretty bumpy. And this is Bloody Basin Road, like right off you after you get off of I-17. You could see I-17 traffic, see those that tour bus maybe and those cars. That's the interstate. So if you've driven between, if you know Phoenix and Flagstaff, that route, that's what you're looking at out there. And I'm using this software I've talked about before called Onyx Offroad. Think of it as just like offline maps, not unlike a Google map with satellite views, but it's not really meant to give you directions from point to point, although there are routes in there. You just kind of monitor digital maps, and I put like waypoints on the map, these little ruins, like in a video game waypoint for all of these Indian ruins out in this area. I did a lot of studying and plotting things on maps, and now I'm seeing the fruits of my labor on the screen. It's pretty sweet. I think we're about to come to a cool reveal also up here. And I think these are just dispersed campsites, by the way, these little pull-offs. I see little campfire things, and we're on the National Monument, so I think you can camp out here. Okay, yeah, so you could see, I mean, I even think like a low clearance vehicle could get through this. So, adventure time. Woohoo! Not a problem. As we go over every little hilltop here, you see a lot of these really like sharp cliff tops and these mesas, and that's like where these people like to build their places. I bet you if you flew a drone around, they say there's up to like 400, I even read maybe up to 450 dwellings scattered all about this place. So yeah, it's just amazing to think that 800 years ago, 1,000 years ago, you had people living up here with no knowledge that these people from Europe were going to be soon discovering this continent, and they lived out in this mysterious world, which is still a mysterious world, and they came over rises like this to see views like that. But just it's interesting to think that the Hohokam and maybe other cultures of the area just all descended in this area. It all seemed to really go down like hard and heavy around the late 13th into the 14th century, so like the 1200s into the 1300s AD. long before you and I and our grandpappy. One of the aspects of this culture that's the most fascinating to me, and you don't hear about it in like the museums or national parks, but you read about it like in some of the papers I've read, is that they talk about periods of conflict. And I've not really read, you know, with who did these people have conflict? Were it like, were they new tribes, maybe the Apache or raiding Indians like the Apache, or maybe other groups like the Yavapai? Were they coming into the area during those times and causing problems? But anyway, there's evidence like at ruins like Sears K, which we visited on that Thanksgiving episode and another older episode. They're just very fortress-like, built on top of inaccessible hills. And you're going to find that kind of stuff all out in this area. So the thing that I find to be the biggest mystery is what was going on during that period to make these people go on the defensive like that. You know, building very like almost like medieval castle like structures on high hilltops, like that kind of stuff. All right, I've made it out to Pueblo La Plata. We got a little bit of walking to do, but here's what we're looking at today. Not too far, we're right over here, and we just gotta walk over here. And there's a fort called Fort Silver, the fort that I mentioned earlier that I wanna go take a look at. So let's go out beyond the cattle guard. All right, I don't know what this mound is. You know, clearly we have to walk out a little ways according to that sign, but is this something like a ball court or something maybe? I don't know. This weird depression here, it's probably nothing, but you gotta wonder sometimes. Either the wind in general just calmed down over the last 30 minutes or so, or this particular area isn't as bad. It's windy, as you can probably hear. And my hand, my fingers are freezing. But I think I can do this. If I keep moving, I should be good to go. And the sign made mention of it, but you can see this volcanic rock. I think this is basalt, is what it's called. Strewn out everywhere here. There's a volcano, an old volcano called Joe's Mountain. I don't know which one it is, but apparently it's the one that exploded long ago and created all this volcanic rock everywhere. The same rock these people used to build the structures we're gonna see, or the remaining structures. So yeah, I can actually see the well-defined walls with my own eyes, but yeah, you can see this bump sticking out. Much thicker in vegetation than some of the nearby areas. And therein lies the trick that I read about, is because vegetation grows in between the walls, it protects it a little bit from the elements, and probably more importantly, it protects it from the cattle, the cows we see here, so they can't get in there and eat that stuff. So it all tends to grow here. Otherwise, I mean, how the heck would you find something like this? I mean, that's really hard to see on foot. And here we go. You get your notices about not screwing with the resources. Leave the pot sherds where you found them. You could see pot sherds all over the ground here. I am pretty certain these are all pieces of pottery all over the ground. Look at that. It's like Homolivi State Park all over again, and it's everywhere. So I'm sure people have set up little stations and put the better stuff, all of the little lithics they're gonna find around here and all the cool stuff, but this is basically saying don't put it in your pocket.
It belongs in a museum.
So yeah, as the sign said, this would have been in the 1200s according to the sign, was when this was the largest of all the communities that these Peri Mesa culture Native Indians built, out of all of the ones that are around here. And I see some pot sherds that are stacked up on a rock over here. Let's go see if there's some cool patterns painted on them. I read that they found lots of different pottery at some of these different structures, from the Salado, the Sanawa Indians, proving the trade networks that went north and south throughout Arizona that we've talked about even in recent times when we visited Montezuma Castle in Montezuma. Well, that's right up the highway from here. And this was a different tradition. Like, these people are almost considered like a separate culture, I think is what they're saying when they talk about these traditions, like the Perry Mesa tradition. And there's even more stuff here. I presume more pottery sherds and lithics. I don't know if these were cutting implements here, this quartz. There's another one down there. It almost looks like some kind of like very sharp edge to it that doesn't seem natural. But yeah, you got pot sherds. The sign out there showed that these would have been, you know, had an outer veneer or masonry on them or mud and smoothed out walls. So this is the inside of the walls and everything's collapsed and ruined. But back in the day, according to the picture, you would have seen like two-story structures. You could only get in through the top through ladders. One of the publications I read said they thought they were one-story structures. Maybe they were talking about some of the outlying communities that would surround these big clusters here of what they call pueblos. The publication I read, which we'll link to down below, I would say is a must read. It's like a visitor's guide written by a college professor or something. I'm assuming he's a knowledgeable guy. But what they referred to these structures are as, I think they call them casarones, which is a Spanish word. And I think the distinction was they didn't really consider these pueblos per se, more of a conglomeration of really tight residences next to each other than what you would think of as at like, you know, Chaco Canyon. I think these were slightly different, but the same idea. Here's some like dark volcanic looking glass stuff. Definitely lithics of some sort, I think, like cutting implements. This is a really sharp, like volcanic glass. It just seems too intentional to not be man-made. And I bet you I could cut my finger open with that, no problem. And I don't know if these have ever really truly been excavated or just vandalized, and that's what we're seeing here. But imagine what things might lay underneath our feet that are yet undiscovered. Not encouraging people to come out here and start playing archaeologist, because I think that would be highly illegal, but just surmising. I mean, are there bodies underneath my feet somewhere? Are there treasures? Are there macaw feathers and turquoise and traded seashells and items like that that these people would have traded with these other nearby cultures? Somewhere out this way, there's like a finger of land. It might be that, it might be that, where there's gonna be a very sheer drop off, I imagine. And then like this finger-like structure, almost like the point of an arrowhead is a way to think about it, or a tip of a spear. Walls that are a fortress that overlook what I assume is gonna be a small canyon below here, probably the one that's Silver Creek. It's called the Silver Creek Fort. It's hard to see from ground level, but you can kind of see the canyon right there. And there's like these fingers of land that point out, like there's three fingers almost, one there, the one we're on, and one right over there. And it's on the very tippy toes, the very edges of these things that they built these forts. There's one in particular that I might do a standalone video on that's on Black Mesa. That has like a 15 foot high wall, and it really gives you the sense of how big these forts were and how impregnable they would have been. This is a really magical part of Arizona. Usually I'm not really into the dead grass look, but, and no trees, no cacti really, but there's something about this that I just feel guilty that I have not come out here to experience this in my almost 20 years in Arizona. What was I thinking? I don't know if this is all that survives, is this back wall, or if there's walls on the side, but you could see they're sizable walls. They didn't want people scaling these things, and they've fallen with time. So I've read these things could be like 15 foot tall, 20 feet tall, and I believe it. This is really cool. I mean, like these sites like this in Sears K, they, you know, behind them you have the village, so they're protecting them from that way. You got these sheer cliffs, so getting someone to go up and over this way is gonna be tough. So it's a really good strategic position, I would think. And probably best seen from the air. And more importantly, what prompted them to feel like they had to do this is really what I wanna know. You know, because these fortifications, like I said, are all over this region of Arizona. So I don't think they did it just for fun and giggles. You can certainly see rock wall here. On this point, it's really fallen over with time. So I imagine it would have been much more grand, but we're pretty much on the tip. I'm gonna make our way all the way there, but you could see the two canyons converge here. So we are almost as far as we can go without dropping straight down 1,000 feet or so. Maybe not 1,000 feet, 600 feet. I don't know. Let's see. Wow. Look at the view from up here. All right, here we are, kind of mostly at the tip. I mean, this is freaky. There's like these really deep holes everywhere between the rocks, and I really don't know how sturdy the edge is. I'm sure it's fine, but I'm really a wimp. But this is beautiful. It's just, I got all this equipment and crap, and it's really windy too, so that's making me nervous, of course. Well, folks, with all the cracks underneath my feet and all this, I think this is the end of the line for us today. Get this beautiful view. I'm gonna take a few snapshots and get back to the car and warm up. It's getting dark too. I really thank you for joining me on this adventure, and I hope you keep coming back for more. I'm gonna say happy trails here and see you next time. Gotta keep my hat on. Bye. Thank you.